Electrification in motorsport is certainly something that's becoming far more widespread, and as the technology catches up, it's also becoming much more applicable to more and more people. I've got Hamish here from University of Canterbury Motorsport, who's going to tell us a little bit about why they've gone electric in their Formula student car and how all that works. So Hamish, we had a look at your electric car before. Can you tell us a little bit about why that thing's electric in the first place? I know you've built both combustion and electric cars in the first place. What are some of the advantages with going with electric powertrain?
Sure, yeah. So I was involved in the first electric powertrain that UCM built. And there's two main drivers. I think one is just the general move toward electrification in transport because of the emissions stuff. And the second is the performance aspect, which is particularly relevant to our competition. You know, an electric car can deliver its maximum torque from anywhere from zero RPM pretty much all the way to top speed. And that presents some real advantages when you're dealing with a lower speed track where you need that power right off the line to lower your lap time.
So what is the general layer of the type of competition you guys do? Is, you mentioned quite low speed, so we're talking quite tight and twisty and stuff like that?
We are, yeah. It's not a lot of room to accelerate for too long, mainly for the safety reasons with student drivers and whatnot. So yeah, it is tight, it is twisty. A lot of, you know, it's just navigating around cones largely. So the ability to get from one corner to the next quickly is really beneficial.
What's the general layout of the type of electric cars you guys are building, the sort of components are involved and the number of motors, stuff like that?
Sure, yeah. I mean, at the heart of any electric car is the energy storage system, predominantly batteries. There are some other technologies that are possibly coming up, like supercapacitors, but these ones all use batteries. The batteries are then connected by a high voltage DC to motor controllers, or inverters as they're sometimes called. They invert the power to AC, which drives the electric motors. You can really choose between two-wheel drive and four-wheel drive. Electric motors make four-wheel drive quite easy because they're much easier to package than a drive shaft running up the length of the car type thing.
Yeah, got you. And what sort of current and voltage ranges are you guys running these cars in?
Sure, yeah. So Formula student cars are limited by rules up to 600 volts. And currents generally run at 100 amps, peaking up to 200 type thing. And yeah, mostly people would aim to get your voltage as high as you can by design. That just reduces your current for the same power and reduces weight of cables and temperature problems, things like that.
Yeah, and when it comes to temperature problems, from what I understand, that's quite a big challenge in any sort of high-performance electric vehicle. What are the cooling circuits in the car? What parts are individually cooled, and how do you go about designing something like that?
Sure, yeah. Battery temperature is a big problem. Mostly I've seen it be air-cooled in Formula student cars, and that's probably the biggest challenge and an area that I think there's probably room for improvement. Other more commercial high-performance vehicles use different kinds of liquid cooling, and that does help. It's a bit of a challenge in Formula student where you're only allowed to use water and maybe oil as a cooling fluid. Mm-hmm. Inverters and motors also present some cooling challenges. They're perhaps a bit more easily cooled. They don't usually have as much thermal mass and the like to deal with.
When you said the batteries tend to be air-cooled, is that a case of forcing air in there, or it's passively with air just being in that part of the battery compartment, or how does that work?
Yeah, I guess it could be done either way. Typically, we've adopted kind of forcing air through a side pod duct, pushing it through the battery and then pulling it out, if necessary, with a fan on the other side. That presents some challenges because the batteries are often really tightly packed together, so there may not be a lot of room for air flow. But yeah, that's basically what we've
done. And does that mean that that battery is all in one big lump? There's no way to actually force air through those individual cells, or is it an option to actually get air through the battery pack itself?
It is an option. It really depends how you lay it out from a mechanical and packaging perspective. The batteries themselves, you can kind of choose pouch cells, which are like the size of a small ruler, really, a bit thicker, almost like an iPhone size type thing. And or you can choose cylindrical cells, which tend to be a little bigger than a AA battery. Mm-hmm. So you have a lot of flexibility as to how you lay those things out. But obviously, creating more room for airflow means a bigger overall volume of your battery pack.
Got you. And coming back to the motor controllers and the motors themselves, how are they cooled? Is that something where you're cooling with fluid and you're running through a heat exchanger, or one or multiple heat exchangers in the car?
Yeah, so the motor controllers are typically bonded to a aluminium heatsink, and water gets run through that, so it's a liquid cooled via a heatsink there. And the motors themselves, we've adopted a process whereby we use a 3D printed nylon cooling jacket around the outside of the motor, and water is pumped through that in kind of a helical fashion around the cylindrical motor.
And what sort of volume of water would you be running in the system? Is this adding quite a lot of weight to the car?
No, I wouldn't say. I don't know the number off the top of my head, but I wouldn't say the volume is adding a lot of weight. Maybe a few kilograms.
Yeah. Look, that's been a really interesting insight into these cars, Hamish. Really appreciate the talk.
No worries. Thanks, Tim.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you subscribe. We're constantly releasing new videos, and if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description of this video to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.